Hey guys, it's me again. Thought I'd do a short video on some pack stoves. We talked a lot about bug out bags, a lot about compact gear, a whole lot about budget gear. Not that I'm knocking high dollar gear. I mean, a lot of times you do get what you pay for. Most often than not, you do get what you pay for, but with that said, there are extremely budget friendly options if you want to put some type of stove into your backpack or your bug out bag. First thing you need to do is think about the expectations from these stoves. There's a lot of different ones on the market. I've got examples of two or three laid out here. These are not designed to cook a whole meal on. You're not going to be cooking cheeseburgers and french fries and macaroni and cheese, although you could. It's just going to take you a while. What these little things are designed for is to get to heat up a quick meal, an MRE or a packet of freeze-dried, or even a squirrel or a rat that you kill ways out in the woods and need to put a little protein in your body. They work really well for quick water boiling, which, as you should know, is one of the easiest and best of ways of cleaning water up, making it safe to drink. Let's talk about what we've got here. I've got three different examples, and all three run three different types of fuel. The first one I have here is a copy of an MSR stove. Let's see if I can get up here where you can see this a little better. Camera's real wide angle, but these are little butane stoves. MSR probably makes the best one on the planet, and they're not outrageous if that's what you want, and if you know you're going to be using it a lot, like a lot of backpackers and cross-country hikers do, you may want to go ahead and splurge and get the MSR. Coleman makes one that's decent. Two or three can be found at Walmart. This little fella here I got by accident. It come off of Amazon. I couldn't begin to tell you the name or the brand of it, but if you hit me up on Facebook, I'll be glad to send you the link where I got it. I say I got it by accident. I was looking for a small backpacking mess kit, something made out of real metal, not thin, flimsy aluminum, and they give this stove with the kit. I didn't even know it came with it. The little mess kit was only like $18 or $19. I don't know about shipping. I've got Amazon Prime, so I've got free shipping. And it was just kind of a neat little surprise. We'll go through the ins and outs of it, too, and when I get done, I'll show you what I'm actually using, my pack. But the little stove comes with a pretty cool little plastic box. It fits in. It's not waterproof, but it fits down in there really well. What you have here, this wire sticking off the end, is your fuel adjustment. The button on the front is a piezo igniter, little push button igniter. Quit working very rapidly after I got it, considering number one, I didn't know I was getting it to begin with, and number two, the use that I get out of this, it's not a big deal just to hit it with a spark from a ferro rod or even a cigarette lighter. The pot stand just roll around and opens up. Got little tabs where you can set a small cup on it. If you want to put a larger pot on it, you can open the tabs up. I'd recommend doing that beforehand, needless to say. To me, the downfall for a stove like this and a bug out bag is the fact that it takes fuel. These run on butane, not propane. The stove simply screws down on top of the fuel canister. Make sure it's off. Pack it back in the box. You have to back it up just a little bit so it'll be on when you put it on the fuel can. So, you know, these are not real heavy, but they do add bulk and weight to your bug out bag. Now, as far as capability of this stove, I'll go ahead and tell you the only thing I've really used it for, other than testing out boiling some water, was when we go camping. I use it a lot of times in the morning to make a pot of coffee. Simply because I may not want to get a fire boiling hot. As of this morning, I have brewed 5 8-cup coffee pots full of coffee off this one cylinder, and it's still going strong. So it is a lot more fuel efficient than I thought it would be. If you're building a bug-out bag for a short-term situation, which truly a bug-out bag really should be, it's just designed to get you from where you're at to where you need to be in the event you have to get out of Dodge. It's not really designed to live off of. Mine's kind of a mixture, but as far as cooking, things like that goes, I just get enough of stuff in there to get me to where I'm going, maybe 3 or 4 days a week at the most. One cylinder might do you if you don't have to use it a whole lot. If you're trying to need water for a whole family, maybe not, I don't know. My use is for this little thing is totally different from what a lot of people's would be. I just thought I'd tell you my experiences with it. The next type of stove we have, again, this is a knockoff of an Esbit stove. And it's basically just a little metal box. Hopefully they'll see us okay on the video. It opens up, it'll lock here, or here. And this is your stovetop. It'll lock here for smaller items. I wouldn't recommend setting anything real, real heavy there because it may collapse down on you. Because it just kind of locks into place by spraying. But for a coffee cup size cup that you need to heat some water up in, something like that, if it's not a real large diameter, if it's too big, put here, it'll work just fine. One modification you could do for this is take your coat hanger and cut some little wires to lay across here and make a little bit of a grid. That way you could open it up all the way and it'd be more sturdy. And you'll be able to set a smaller diameter vessel of some type on top. You could burn pretty much anything you wanted, I guess, in this, you know, if you had to. I've used small alcohol burners, little beer can stoves, some of you may have seen or seen me make in the past. What it's actually designed for is these little fuel tabs. This is one here, and they burn really clean, they're non-toxic. The stove itself comes with a pack of 4 tabs, kind of like what you see here. You can store 2 packs for a total of 8 inside there. My experience is with this stove, what I've used in this particular one here is brand new. I've got several of these. You can boil 8 ounces of water easily off of 1 tab. You can heat 16 ounces of water to scalding hot, not to purify, but maybe if you just needed really, really hot water for a drink or for a meal or something like that to mix with some type of freeze-dried food or your MREs or whatever, it would work for that. Other than that, it will burn out fairly quickly. I mean, it's not like putting a cotton ball down in there. Like I said, 1 tab will boil an 8-ounce cup of water every time and still have a little life left. The thing I like about this is it's really light, really compact, and you can buy these all over. These come off of Amazon, and I'm wanting to say I only spent about $4 each. Walmart sells one that seems to hold up just as good. I see very little difference between the cheapest ones I've seen at Walmart and the $20 Esbit brand. There may be a difference in the fuel tabs. The little Esbit tabs seem like they may burn a little longer. This is an off-brand here of some type. I don't know if there's a difference in the chemical composition of the tabs or not. But these work really well. They're extremely light. The whole package only weighs a few ounces, even with the fuel tabs in there. And to me, for a bug-out bag, it's a pretty good setup because you're not looking for cooking a whole meal. You're not talking about camp cooking. If I'm going to be somewhere long enough to eat a big full meal, then I've probably got time to build me a fire and do things the right way. This is for emergencies when you may be needing to get your water heated or your food heated up quickly and then get back on the move again. This last one looks really rough. There's a story behind that, but this again is an Amazon product called the Pocket Folding Cooker. It was black at one time. I've had this for several years. Used it quite a bit. It's a little heavier than any of these. You're probably looking at a pound and a half, maybe even pushing 2 pounds. It's made out of pretty thick sheet metal. Comes with this little nylon bag that I didn't think would hold up for squat, but it's worked pretty good so far. Like I said, it was black at one time. The original paint burned off while it was the first time I used it. I've done a video on this stove before. I've also done a modification or two on it to make it easier to set up. And it's still not real easy. It all just folds up. And to set it up, you simply unfold it. Bring the sidewalls around and they hook together. The floor is a little tricky, but it's not a big deal. That's basically it there. The little door opens up for your feed your fuel thing. Now, fuel. This will burn on anything burnable. Anything. Fuel tabs. Alcohol burners sitting down inside it. You could even take hot coals out of your fire if you needed to do something small and that you need to control a little bit better and just stick the hot coals up inside there. It's called a biofuel stove, and all that means is anything biological that you can find laying around in nature, it will burn. Leaves, twigs, sticks, animal poo has been dried up. Yes, that's gross, but if it's dried up, it burns really well. A little handful of fuel I've got back here. If you can see it, I've got some small sticks, some medium size, and a couple pieces of larger ones is enough to keep this thing going. You can cook a decent meal on that. It's going to take a while, and you're going to need to use smaller pots and pans, primarily because the opening in the top is not real big, and you're not going to get good heat dispersion. The biggest downfall of the stove, other than it weighing a little bit more, is the fact that you have to constantly feed it. It's not designed to use larger pieces of wood. As a matter of fact, much larger than the size of my thumb is really too big. It doesn't do very well. And these smaller stuff, you have to constantly tend it. Now, with that said, you also don't have to pack any fuel with you of any kind. Everything around me will burn. These dry leaves, sticks, twigs, tree bark will burn in it, and it'll do just fine. I think what I'm going to do is test fire it up real quick here in a minute and show y'all how efficient it can be. The heat comes out really good. It's real easy to do. It's just a simple matter of having to sit here and constantly feed it. Stick with me. Be back in just a minute. Let me get a few things ready, and we'll fire up the little pocket cooker. Okay. I'm going to move a few things out of the way here so you can kind of focus on the little pocket folding cooker. I'll just be able to see halfway decent. All I've got is just a small piece of fat wood, and I'm not going to waste my time getting out a ferrocerium rod or flint and steel and doing this the old-fashioned way. It can be done. It can be done easily. But I want to keep things realistic, because if you're using this stove, you're probably in a hurry. If you're using any of these, you're in a hurry to get the heat going and get whatever it is heated up. I don't care what kind of survivalist you are, what kind of prepper you are, how much you're into bushcraft or woodcraft or primitive skills. If you're doing this stuff for your imminent survival, if your bug out bag is for your imminent survival, put a cigarette lighter in it. I could sit here and work for hours building a bow drill set and getting an ember and transferring that ember to a piece of char and transferring that char to a bird nest, getting the bird nest going, adding more tinder material and kindling into that, or I could just pick up a small piece of fat wood that I've either A, collected, or B, packed up. I keep quite a bit packed with me and light this stuff up. piece of fat wood in and let it get burning a little bit. If you got the flower set up properly on this, then you got a little bit of a vent up underneath and it burns really well. If you're sitting on really uneven ground and you want to use this cooker, you might want to take your hands and rake out a little bit of a ditch, if you will, up underneath so air will flow a little better. I've used it a lot of times sitting on tree stumps. Works great there. So if we can start adding a little fuel to the fire here. You can load it straight through the top. If you had a lot of loose, small, highly combustible material, doesn't really matter. Just like with any fire, you have to go slow. Don't overfeed the fire. Add a piece or two at a time so it gets going. Give that just a couple of minutes to take off. There we go. And you can't see inside this, but just build your fire just like you would if it was a big campfire. Just use small pieces doing it. Zealous there and smothered it. Let that fat wood burn up the sides of it a little bit more. If you're not familiar with fat wood, we'll talk about it a lot more in another video. It's basically pieces of pine that have come from a wounded area in the tree. By wounded, I mean there's sap coming out of it. And that sap, that resin, is extremely, extremely flammable in pine trees. It's the basis behind what turpentine is made out of, which is a type of paint thinner. Highly combustible. Pine tar itself is really, really combustible material. And this fat wood is the best resource you could ever put in your bug out bag, in my opinion. It doesn't take a lot of it. I know some of you may be sitting here thinking, well, why would I want to carry around chunks of wood in my backpack? Well, I'll tell you why. Because that one little bit piece I used in here, I could have started this fire with a lot of babying and a lot of care. A lot of love. I could have started that fire with a piece the size of a dime. If you plan your fire out right and have everything prepared, you're using decent tinder, even down to marginal tinder and kindling, that piece of fat wood is indispensable to help get your fire going. That burn a little longer this time before I add more to it. All these little sticks and stuff I'm using, I've just picked up off the ground. Probably soaked up a lot of ground moisture overnight. It'll work fine, just gotta go a little slower with it. As you can see, we're starting to burn pretty decent in here. Took me a little longer than I thought it would to get the fire going. Sometimes these things can be finicky. It's all about the quality of the fuel you're feeding it. Ended up having to drop a few pieces of dry leaves you got laying all around us here down inside it to help get more combustible material in there. But it is now going, and what you can do is be careful because it's hot. you can close that door down. I would always recommend having something, pocket knife or whatever, because this little tab on this door does get hot. You can close it down. As you can see, it directs most of the heat straight up. I would recommend continually feeding it through the side here. As always, if you're messing with fire, be careful. Especially if you're not, you know, if you didn't grow up doing these things. You're going to start putting some larger chunks of wood in and get this thing really rolling here. This is about as big as you'll ever need to use in this. Once that gets burning good right there, that'll start generating a lot of heat out that top. And bear in mind, if you're using this in a wilderness location, kind of like I am, it gets hot. It will get hot enough to catch leaves and anything around it on fire. So don't leave it unattended. It will be best if you cleared out all this debris from around here. Or, like I've said in the past, use a tree stump. I like using this a lot in the past, just sitting on an old tree stump. You almost always find one laying around. That's burning pretty decent. I'm going to go ahead and drop the door. See how that little leg stayed there? That works real well to allow it to get plenty of wind. If you use a marginal tinder or fuel and you have any breeze blowing whatsoever, think about that, just like you would setting your shelter up or whatever, and turn the opening into the breeze. It'll help fuel it more, just like having to blow on or fan your fire. All right, that's burning good, so I'm going to go ahead and drop the lid all the way down. As you can see, it's directing the flame straight up out the top, almost like it would a rocket stove. And it cooks really well. The biggest difference between how this functions and the way a real rocket stove would function is the sidewalls are not insulated, so you are still losing a lot of heat out the side. So I've had a pocket cooker from Amazon. I think it sells for about $12 or $14. I've had this one. That's about what I paid for this one. I've had it for several years, as you can see. It's been, like I said before, it was black to begin with. First time I used it, the cheap paint cooked right off of it. It's been rusted and repainted many, many, many times over. Don't expect it to look new again, ever, after the first use. It will look just as bad, if not worse. But it works, and it works really well. Now, as far as which one I prefer out of these three for my bug out bag, I'm going to go ahead and tell you. This one is not it. Just simply because I don't want the extra weight and the bulk of the cylinder. If you have room in your bag and you feel like this is the way to go, it will work and it will work really well for you. I do keep it around for camping trips, like we're on right now, if you're on Dale Hollow Lake, because it's handy, but it does not go in my bug out bag. Not that it's a bad thing, it just doesn't work for me. The pocket cooker I've got cooking right now, I've used it quite a bit, and I do like it. I like it a lot. It folds down to about the size of a paperback book. The little Esbit stove, for my purposes, work just as good. And they're the lightest of the three, even with the fuel. I can take this little stove here with all 8 tabs. It'll fold up, and it weighs about a half a pound. So it's really light. I just keep that in my bug out bag. There may come a time when I change my mind again and switch back to something like this pocket cooker. And there's other brands out there. There's some that are really, really nice and a little bit easier to put together. Bushbox makes them. Emberlit makes a really nice one. You can get them as inexpensive like this as you want, or as expensive as you want. Emberlit and Bushbox both make them in titanium, which are incredibly light. If I had one of those, I might would go back to the biofuel stove, just simply because I never have to worry about fuel. I'll find fuel for it somewhere, almost all the time. Why haven't I bought a titanium one, you may ask? Because it's titanium. It's expensive. I find it a little better to put the $50 it would take to buy that little bitty stove into something else. Just my personal preference. If you have the money or want to spend the money on the titanium biofuel stoves like this one or something similar, by all means do it. You will be happy with it. They're very light. If you're looking for the most bang for the buck, get you a little Esbit stove. Again, it doesn't have to be Esbit brand. You can go to Walmart and get one by Ozark Trail. You can buy dozens and dozens of different brands all over Amazon. You're going to spend less than $5 for the stove and enough fuel to fire it up 5 or 6 times. If bulk is not an issue, then certainly the butane cookers are great. It gets really hot, really fast, and even this ultra cheap one, which I'm sure is made somewhere in China, doesn't even have a brand name on it, is incredibly efficient. They're incredibly compact. Like I said, this one just fits down inside the little box. That's it. Just have to evaluate your needs, your space requirements. Again, space is a premium. I would choose this one or the wood-fired stove. If space and weight are at a premium, go with the Esbit style. It's kind of my 2 cents worth. Hope this helps somebody out. Hope y'all enjoy it. Appreciate you watching. Check us out on Facebook on Tennessee Survivalist. If you know me personally, feel free to hit me up on Facebook. If you're a member of the group I'm associated with and you have any further questions, y'all know how to get a hold of me. If you would, take the time to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. There'll be a lot more coming up soon. Hopefully, I've been making a lot more videos this week, and within the next week or two, there'll be several new videos, a lot of new content on my YouTube channel, a lot more content on my Facebook page. Until next time, appreciate it.